So in Louisville, Kentucky, there's a movement to turn a number of counties into Second Amendment sanctuaries, and it has been gaining traction, big time traction. Joining me right now is Congressman Thomas Massie, who represents the beautiful 4th District of Kentucky. Congressman, always a pleasure to have you. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me on. And you know what? Until the first Tuesday in November, we didn't think we needed a sanctuary county movement. But lo and behold, every Republican on the ballot, we have off-year election, statewide ballot, one except for our governor. We have a Democratic governor right now. And so people weren't expecting that to happen. And couple that with the fact that some Republicans in Kentucky have started talking about red flag legislation, and they had a hearing on it in November. And so the Second Amendment sanctuary county movement has come to Kentucky, and literally since November, it has spread across the state. We have 120 counties, and I'm guessing probably 80 of them are Second Amendment sanctuary counties now.
I love hearing that, although it still scares me that that you have to do that in Kentucky of all places, because you know, that's not too far away from Texas. It's kind of making me nervous a little bit. Let me ask you this, because so many of these, of the Second Amendment sanctuaries, these that counties have voted for, I get that they're symbolic. What is the tactic here? I mean, obviously, optically, I think it's incredibly important. But what happens if push comes to shove and the governor wants to challenge it and the governor wants to push back? I know that there are certain states that have different ways of dealing with things. And some states' constitutions allow for counties to do such things. Others, they have to go by the state rule. How does that affect these Second Amendment sanctuaries in Kentucky?
Well, if you'll remember, a few years ago, we had a county clerk who refused to issue marriage licenses under the federal judge. And ironically, the judge was a Republican and she was a Democrat. And he put her in jail, found her in contempt of court. And so what can happen is when local officials stand up to defend the Constitution, they can find themselves not by a trial, not by a jury, but just the judge says, I find you in contempt, I'm putting you in jail. And so even though these seem to be largely symbolic, they're important, one, because it's a gut check on the local officials. Okay, we elected, you know, this guy, we thought he was our friend, and he can't even vote for this resolution. I mean, it's not even an ordinance. And so we've been able to out some of the local people who said they were pro-gun until they had to put their name on the ballot. The other thing is, I'm sure you know Sheriff Steve Reams out in Weld County, Colorado. I invited him to D.C., and he came to the Second Amendment caucus, which I run. We had 24 congressmen come to hear Sheriff Steve Reams because he said he's willing to go to his own jail before he will enforce these laws. Now, that's not just a symbolic thing or a political ploy, because his reasoning is we need to challenge the laws in Colorado, and rather than arrest one of my constituents and put them through it, why don't I let the judge arrest me? And or, you know, contempt, whatever it turns out to be. And then I'll go through the court case and the county commissioners there in Weld County. It's become more than symbolic because Sheriff Steve Reams tells me they voted to cover his court fees. And so that's how this can become significant. And that's how what seems like meaningless legislations and resolution are symbolic. They're not meaningless. They're very symbolic. They turn into real things.
Right. No, that's good to know. And that kind of reminds me of what was it's a Culpeper County Sheriff, Sheriff Jenkins, who in Virginia, who said, well, I'll just deputize everyone. Has that been something that's come up in any of these Kentucky counties, Congressman? Do you have any sheriffs saying, well, I'll just deputize people? I mean, and obviously what Jenkins was talking about wasn't, you know, going after every single person out there and saying, you're a deputy, bippity-boppity-boo. I mean, obviously they would have to go through the paperwork and they would be checked, et cetera.
Dana, that's so retro, because in Kentucky, like I grew up here in Kentucky in a very rural county. I think we had a sheriff at one point who had 50 deputies, none of whom were paid. And basically, that was before you could get a concealed carry permit. Sheriffs used to do that. You remember, like back when I was a kid, even in Kentucky, it was almost impossible to get a permit to conceal carry. So people went to the sheriff and said, hey, I'd like to be a deputy. He said, here's a badge. You know, well, he would know the person, he would vet them, and they could carry a gun. He didn't pay him, he didn't buy him a uniform, And so that's actually been tried before, maybe not publicly, but it has been done to some degree 20, 30, 40 years ago before they had such things as concealed carry permits, or now we have wonderfully constitutional carry in Kentucky.
Yeah, we need to see and see. Everyone's like, oh, Texas is, and I love my adopted state of Texas, and I love my home state of Missouri, but gosh dang, you guys are beating us in that constitutional carry with that. We got to get on that. To play devil's advocate for a moment, I've heard from some folks that obviously I necessarily agree with them. I understand what they're asking, but I don't share the opinion. They've stated, well, why not just fight this out through the courts? Some people have tried to make the argument that Second Amendment sanctuary somehow upends the rule of law, and that, well, why not just fight this out at the ballot box and through the courts? What do you say to those people when they suggest that as the alternative?
Well, first of all, if you've seen Congress right now, the devil has enough advocates. So, but I'm glad you're playing devil's advocate on this. Well, you know, that's, again, the sanctuary county movement fits hand in glove with the court strategy, because you, like in Sheriff Steve Dream's case, he's ready to go to court, but you have to have standing to go to court, which means you first have to have your rights taken away, and then you've got to have some money to defend it. And, you know, you can litigate this. I think it will be litigated. The question is, are you going to have the support of people? By the way, a lot of these, they're not federal judges, but judges are elected in Kentucky, and they stand for re-election. Mm-hmm. So it's not a bad thing for them to see that the electorate, how they feel on this. And by the way, you know, there was a movement a few years ago with people trying to explain jury nullification. But it is a fact. The jury has more power than they realize. They can, and so I hope this Second Amendment sanctuary movement, I hope it becomes sort of instructional toward future and potential jurists in these cases that you're talking about, for the people who say, well, let's litigate it, let's take it to court. Yeah, and let's make sure the jurors who end up being picked actually know that if they don't think the law is constitutional or the sentence is just, they don't have to convict the person.
Yeah, and I'm glad that you're also focusing on the courts and the judicial side of it as well, because as I just said coming into your intro, there was the California case. This just happened like 2 or 3 days ago, where a Clinton-appointed judge, which did actually surprise me, a Clinton-appointed judge just rejected entirely. It was Everytown and the Giffords group, I don't know, all the Bloomberg groups, the Brady groups, whatever. They were trying to file amicus briefs in this in one of these gun control cases in California. And the judge said, look, you're so biased. You're a friend of the, we can't have you in here. We can't have you filing this brief. And I think when after the election, I was telling everyone, we're getting into a judicial agenda as opposed to a legislative agenda. And I want you to talk for a minute the significance of just this administration and all the Republicans, the importance of all of these judges that have been appointed and have been confirmed. I know that there were some just the other day, as it relates to not just the Second Amendment, but the sanctuary movement also.
It's hugely important. I mean, the Senate, I mean, you know, the Democrats in the House are complaining that the Republicans in the Senate aren't passing all the bad bills that they've passed in the House. Guess what the Republicans in the Senate are doing? They're confirming all of these other judges, and everybody focuses on the Supreme Court judges. It's sort of like the Super Bowl, right?
Yeah.
And they're not watching the regular season. Well, you don't get to the Super Bowl unless you play in a regular season. And these are the judges that are going to determine which cases basically get sent up to the Supreme Court. And it's really important. And, you know, in Washington, D.C., I'm going to go ahead and say this. Maybe I shouldn't. I got my concealed carry permit, and I helped some other congressmen get the training, too. So there's more than one of us.
Nice.
But it was only possible because of a lower court ruling. Here's what happened. You know, D.C., they lost to Dick Heller.
Right.
Prevailed. And then they kept ignoring it, and they kept getting in trouble with the court. And so then they said, well, you got to have a good reason to get a permit. And then so D.C. said, well, we haven't heard of a good reason yet. And so they said, that's a virtual ban. So they So they lost all their cases. It was going to go to the Supreme Court, but Illinois and Hawaii and New York called them up and said, don't contest it. Don't take it to the Supreme Court. Take your lumps and become shall issue. So Washington, D.C., this is so hard for me to believe, because when I went there when I was first elected, I never thought this would happen.
Yeah.
Because of a lower court ruling, is shall issue.
That's amazing. I know. I can't believe it happened either. It was shocking to see that. Let me ask you this. Obviously, we're going into an election year, so I don't expect a lot of movement on any kind of Second Amendment issues. It seems that a lot of lawmakers kind of stay away from that during an election year. But after that, what is your expectation of any kind of Second Amendment, you know, whether it's national reciprocity, whether it's the Hearing Protection Act, whether it's all of this stuff? What do you foresee happening to some of these proposals that have been stalling out?
Well, at the federal level, we're still on defense, and we've got to fight red flag laws.
Mm.
When I was down in the skiff for Adam Schiff's witness tryouts, when the hearings were secretive,
right.
I was down there. I turned to one of my colleagues and I said, you know what? It's been a month since I have heard anybody on Capitol Hill talk about gun control, and I hate that this is happening to the president, and this is a total waste of time for us to be down in this skiff. But if this is the price we pay for them to lose their agenda and their focus, and we can keep the red flag laws from happening, I said, I'll stay down in this basement skiff for the rest of Congress.
I agree with that.
So we're on the defensive, but fortunately, it's unfortunate because it's a waste of time, but it's a waste of Nancy Pelosi's agenda, which is actually a good thing. So, you know, that's sort of cooled down some.
I think they wasted their political capital on that. I don't think that there's any chance that the president's going to compromise with them on anything after this impeachment stunt.
No. And thank goodness. So I think the action is at the state levels. I'm hopeful that some states can get some more constitutional carry. You know, wink, wink, nod, nod, Texas there.
Mm-hmm.
But to this point, if I may say this, there's a big rally at the Kentucky State Legislature in Frankfort January 31st, and I'm going to speak there, and there are going to be some other speakers, and the legislators are in session. And this is, you know, the school teachers do this when they talk about their pensions. You know, they go down there and they stare the legislators in the face, and they move the agenda. The gun rights activists, Second Amendment, right to keep and bear arms, we need to be there.
Yes.
And I know I'm a federal legislator and these are state legislators, but
still,
because I have a voice, and because I live in Kentucky and I'm going to have
to
live under
their
laws, I'm going to be there January 31st in Frankfort. It's from like 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., but I'm going to speak around 1 p.m. and I'm going to have a special guest.
We'll keep an eye on that as well for info for folks. You know what? You're talking about all this just gave me, you know what this kind of makes me think of? Back in like 2007, when they had the Don't Go movement with Nancy Pelosi and Republican members of Congress, they stayed in the House chamber, and Pelosi shut the power off and the cameras off, and they all left and went on recess.
Yeah,
it reminds me of those early days of the Tea Party movement, the Second Amendment sanctuary movement. That's what it really does. It has the same momentum, has the same energy.
I think it's more powerful. I went to one of these court meetings where in my own county, because it was over Christmas break and we were out of session, in a town of 1,400 people, in a county that only has 14,000 people, 200 people showed up on a work day. It was standing room only in this courtroom, and it passed unanimously. And everybody who got up to speak was on message. Like, and if anybody wandered off to make it a partisan issue, or make it about an election, or to talk about some of the other conservative causes, the next speaker got up and said, no, we are here for one thing and one thing only. We are here to assert our sect. So they have a focus that's even more intense, and I actually think they're better organized, at least here in Kentucky, than the Tea Party movement, which I was a part of in 2010, 2012. Mm-hmm. The Second Amendment Sanctuary County, Sanctuary City movement is more focused, more organized, and it's got more intensity. I think it's I think a lot of politicians are going to get a taste of it. It's going to be like an electric fence. One of these meetings, there are basically three commissioners and a head commissioner in Kentucky called the county executive. The county executive abstained from the vote, and the room was full. It probably had 300 people, And they started.
People are turning out.
I mean, just like
they're turning out. Unfortunately, I have to get rolling, Congressman.
Well,
but
he changed his vote. I just want to let you know he changed his vote in the face of all these people.
That's amazing. See, that's what happens when people turn out. Congressman Thomas Massie, at Rep. Thomas Massie on Twitter. Always a pleasure talking with you, Congressman. Appreciate your fight, and we'll talk again soon, I'm sure. Thank you.